All right, welcome everyone. So we are the youth transportation students, and we have a forum today presented, developed by high school students and college youth who, with the goal of giving elected officials insight into the needs of youth across San Diego who disproportionately ride public transit. My name is Wesley Cooksey. I am a first year graduate student at San Diego State University studying my master's in city planning. And next slide, please. Okay, so before we get started, I'd like to remind everyone that this is a public meeting and that we would love to hear your opinions and needs, but out of respect for those speaking, please make sure to put your comments down in the chat and we will have someone take a look at them and address a handful of comments at specific points during the meeting. That said, elected officials, we also want to give you a chance to ask questions as well. So please feel free to use the chat if you want. Please note, we will be recording this meeting and the recorded file will be emailed out following the town hall. And finally, we would like to encourage all participants, if you're comfortable, to rename your Zoom profile to include your pronouns, just to make an all-inclusive environment. Okay. Next slide. Okay, so today we are standing on the ancestral lands of the Kumeyaay people, the original native inhabitants of San Diego County. The Kumeyaay have lived in this region for more than 10,000 years. Kumeyaay lands once extended from the Pacific Ocean, south to Encinitas, east to the sand dunes of the Colorado River, and north to Warner Springs Valley. Today, we pay respect to the Kumeyaay elders, past and present. Please take a moment to consider the legacies of violence, displacement, migration, and settlement that bring us together here today. Okay, and finally, we'd like to thank our partners, the San Diego Climate Action 350, Green New Deal at UCSD, the Mid-City CAN, and Youth for Climate, Green Love, a division of associate students at San Diego State, and the American Federation of Teachers. We'd like to thank you all for helping us out and getting this presentation started. And now I will pass to Kiala.
Thank you so much, Wesley. Well, I'm Kiala, and I am so honored to lead the introductions for our four amazing elected officials and people who will be on our panel today. So I want to get it started by having everyone, each of our panelists, go around and introduce themselves for about a short minute. Just tell us what you do, what your position is, and why you're excited to be here. So why don't we start with County Board Supervisor Tara Lawson Remer.
Hi. Great to be here. I'm Supervisor Lawson Remer, she, they, and I'm our supervisor. So that's what I do. And I grew up in San Diego. I'm really excited to be on this panel because I think transit is vitally important for our region's future. I bike a lot. And one thing I think about all the time is that we need protected and connected bike lanes. I take my 2.5-year-old on my bike and it does not feel safe. And we really need to do something about that. I also live in Encinitas and work downtown at the county building. And really excited about the idea of having a train that could get me from Encinitas to downtown in 17 minutes, which is the plan. You know, if we're able to make these transit investments that we've been talking about with SANDAG. And the last thing is also just, you know, we talk a lot about, I think, folks who want to use transit and, you know, want to use mass transit, want to bike, about, you know, us as users. But the thing I always tell my parents, who definitely, you know, both don't bike and are not going to be taking the train everywhere, and like a lot of my voters, is you should be real happy if we get 10% of people, young people, out of their cars and onto the train and onto their bike, because 10% less cars on the road means zero traffic for you all who are still going to be driving, which is, you know, really important to keep in mind that, you know, there are a lot of folks in our region who are not going to be taking transit, and that is totally okay. You all, our young folks, are our future and can get in the train, and then our rest of our population won't have as much traffic on their streets. And, you know, I think that's a win-win, because that means that we're going to all be willing to to invest in those solutions to improve traffic and commutes and getting around our region. So just excited to be here. Thanks.
Yes, thank you so much. And again, we are very excited that you're here as well. Next, why don't we go with Encinitas Mayor and SANDAG Chair, Catherine Blakespear.
Yes. Hello, good evening, everybody. Thank you for having me. My name is Catherine Blakespear, and I serve as the mayor in the city of Encinitas. I've been the mayor for 5 years, and I'm also the chair of SANDAG. So SANDAG is the county's regional transportation agency that has all 18 cities in the county that sit on the board. And we just at this very moment are on the verge of adopting a new regional plan for transportation, which basically means how will you get around in 2050? So 30 years from now, what kind of transportation will we see in this county? And I'll say that I grew up here. My family's fourth generation. I'm fourth generation here in Encinitas, but I went to school in Chicago. I went to Northwestern, and I did internships in DC, in New York City, and I've traveled in other places. And in Chicago, I took the L everywhere. You know, I really recognize the benefits of good transit. And I recognize that we don't have it here. And as a young person, being able to live in much more urban settings, but to see the flexibility and the freedom that good transit can give you with relatively little money and no need to store a car or pay for insurance or create a carbon footprint. You know, it can be very freeing. And so the transportation plan at SANDAG really invests in transit and also active transportation. So biking and walking infrastructure, which is really important to me and something I've championed as the mayor in my city for the last 7 years. I was on the council for 2 years before being mayor. But I'll just say, you know, I know there are 56 of you on this call who are the next generation. You know, we know if we want to fight climate change that the biggest sector is transportation that produces emissions, and having a cleaner and greener and faster transportation network is key to meeting our climate goals. So always connecting the transportation improvements with the climate goals is critical. But also, you know, we need to generate the political will to fight back against basically car culture. Like, there is a very strong ethic in San Diego County that people all mostly have cars if they can. So as soon as someone gets enough money to get a car, they buy one. So the other narrative of like transit is good, biking and walking is good. If you're going a quarter of a mile, you don't need to get in your car. Making those choices, articulating the reason behind them, are saying it's a value for you. You know, that is so important because the civic dialogue is defined by who participates. So being able to push back and say, hey, there are other things and other ways that we want to get around, there's just, that is invaluable. So I'm excited to be here tonight and to hear the feedback that you have and the questions you have. And I thank you for your engagement. It's great that there are so many people on this.
Yes, thank you. And I'm sure all the students are very interested in hearing what you have to say. Moving on to our third panelist and the elected official that will be with us, La Mesa Councilmember Jack Shu.
Thank you, and thanks for having me on this panel. I am thrilled to be here and to be here with both Catherine Blakespear, Mayor, and Supervisor Tara Larson Remer, and of course Teddy as well, representing Councilmember Campbell's office. You know, my background was in civil service. I was a park superintendent for 29 years with California State Parks, got into trying to save the forest. And one of the things that we learned actually 40 years ago is you can't save the forest by just dealing with the forest. In fact, we have to save the cities. And that's why when I got involved with the Cleveland National Forest Foundation and Save Our Forests and Ranchlands, we concentrated on working on better city building. And the key component of that was land use and transportation. And when it came to transportation for San Diego, just like with land use for that matter, we're in pretty sad shape. We're pretty bad. So that's my background after being with the Cleveland National Forest Service, Cleveland National Forest Foundation, for 25 years. Something got into me. I ran for public office, and something really weird happened, and I got elected and became a city council member. And because of the situation here in the city of La Mesa, the mayor has a full-time job and conflict of interest with other council members. Being a freshman council member, I was up to be able to represent the city on the SANDAG board. But I come to the SANDAG board with a fair amount of experience. The Cleveland National Forest Foundation over 10 years ago was involved with transportation to quite extent. In fact, we sued SANDAG and we won. So that gave me a lot of insight into regional transportation plans, environmental review processes, and the status of transportation in our region. And as we talk about transportation and transit, I just want to make sure that we get our minds straight. Transportation, remember, is about moving people, goods, and services. It's not about moving bikes. It's not about moving cars. It's goods and services and people. We can't have bikes for fun. We can have cars for fun and for recreation. That's fine. But most of the time, we need these other instruments, buses and transit, to get us around or get goods and services around. So as long as we have that in our mindset, I think we can do better planning. And as we go forward in this discussion, I hope we really do talk about the how deep structurally flawed our systems are. And I'm speaking of planning processes, terminology, as well as the information gap that we have and the huge challenges we have in our region. So I hope we get to that level because we really need organizations that all of you represent, 350.org, MidCityCan, to get information out. We have a huge information gap. I'm hoping that all segments of our population, our communities, youth, and as well as seniors and middle income and other groups participate in this process. But of course, I'm counting on young people to really carry that banner for you, since you have the most amount in stake with regards to our future, but also because you have the energy, skills, and knowledge set to change and to make things happen. So I'll end it there.
Thank you so much, and really interested and excited to get into that discussion later on tonight. Last but not least, we have Teddy Martinez representing San Diego City Council President Jennifer Campbell from District 2. So do you wanna, Teddy, take it away.
Thank you, Keila. No, thank you all for putting this together. I wanna thank each and every one of you for staying engaged in your community. It is so delightful to see young people getting involved in this process. You are the reason why these changes occur. And it's just so impressive to see how many folks are here, especially the high school students who are willing to take time to advocate for something that is so important. So I commend you all for being involved and doing this work. Like Kara said, I represent City Council President Jennifer Campbell. She represents District 2, which encompasses a lot of coastal communities. I grew up in East County, San Diego. I lived as a child in Chicago. So I want to kind of echo Mayor Blakespear's understanding of how transportation can work and really how different it is here in such a spread out region that we have in San Diego County. To me, a lot of this comes down to access. How do we access different parts of the region easily? How do we get from East County, San Diego to the coastal district that Council President Campbell represents to enjoy those things? How can we do that with respect to climate so that it's clean to do it, so that it's friendly to future generations? How can we innovate past the kind of old systems that we have that are car focused and move into new innovative approaches that allow us to get around, not just for recreation, but for jobs, for our economy? How do we get folks to spread that money around the county more efficiently and more easily so they can get their kids to school, so that kids can get to their jobs, so that families can move around? Like Councilmember Chu said, it's about a transportation goods and services movement. I was a Senate fellow in the California State Senate, and one of my first committees was the Senate Transportation and Housing Committee. And when I first got it, I was like, housing, transportation, they're totally different things, but they're really not. Where you live matters and transportation matters. We see that with inequities around how certain goods and movements pass communities that then end up having to take the hit of health issues, if that is smog or heavier emissions in their communities. And so I do think that this is such an important issue. Access is hugely important. I commend the panelists today that are here who have pushed, including Council President Campbell, who have pushed the initiative to have youth access to free transportation in this region, which is included in the next SANDAG budget. And so I really do commend you all for putting this together. Transportation is a hugely antiquated system in San Diego. And so I really look forward to your input, and I'm positive that your information will be relayed to Council President Campbell as she does her work to make our region more equitable, more accessible, and cleaner to the environment. So thank you all for having me, and excited to hear your input.
Yes, thank you, Teddy. We appreciate you being on this call so much. And with that, I'm going to pass it to Katie so we can take a quick photo.
Hello, I'm Anna Birmingham. I'm a 10th grader at Point Loma High School, and I go by she, her. So the regional plan is a long-term blueprint for how the San Diego region will grow and how we will get around. It is a broad-based community effort that addresses many important issues, including the ones listed here. This plan is particularly important for transportation. Next slide. San Diego Forward. The 2021 regional plan is designed to make sure that San Diego County residents have the flexibility to travel to what matters most, the people we want to see and the places we want to go. Next. This plan includes the five big moves, which is going to greatly improve our transit system. The five big moves include complete corridors. Complete corridors provide a variety of travel choices and use technology to manage how highways and major roads are used in real time. They provide a balance of dedicated, safe spaces for everybody, including freight vehicles and people who walk, bike, drive, ride transit, and use flexible fleets. Transit lead. High speed, high capacity, high frequency transit. It will mean new high speed transit lines, longer service, prioritizing transit on lanes, better integration with transit, better light rails, buses, and commuter rails. Mobility hubs. Land use focus on offering transit, housing, jobs in the same location. Flexible fleets, micro-mobility, including bikes, scooter, rideshare, and first and last mile operation. Next OS, an operating system. We are at a critical moment to advance the transportation justice, and this plan will dictate San Diego public transit for the next three decades and beyond. While the plan is the boldest that SANDAG has ever proposed, it will still take too long for there to be enough changes for public transit to be a competitive alternative to cars and address our climate crisis. It is key that we advocate for the plan to pass and for it to be stronger now. Next slide. Inadequate investment in the mass transit system has harmed and continues to harm our most vulnerable communities, health, and quality of life, which prompted the formation of the San Diego Transportation Equity Working Group. The STTEWG is a coalition of the listed environmental, health, and community organizations, San Diego 350, Center on Policy Initiatives, Environmental Health Coalition, Mid-City CAN, and City Heights, who represent the priorities that frontline communities have identified and reflect a vision that will advance the best transit solutions for all of San Diegans. Therefore, the STTEWG asks that the 10 transit lifelines be included in the 2021 regional plan and for the following changes to be made. The 10 transit lifelines include a regional plan that prioritizes environmental justice, youth opportunity passes, bus service every 10 minutes, a Blue Line Express, 24-hour service, the Purple Line, an all-electric bus fleet by 2030, anti-displacement strategies, restroom access, and emergency-ready transit system. These lifelines are community-generated, and the implement is key for advancing transportation justice. I will now pass it to Ravi to discuss transportation justice.
Hi, I wanted to talk about transportation justice. My name is Ravi and I'm at Mesa College. And I'm gonna talk about why transportation justice is important. The definition of transportation access is equal access of all people to transportation they need for a better quality of life. Transportation is critical to ensure that people have access to jobs, education, and to seeing loved ones and friends, accessing healthcare and groceries and many other critical needs. Transportation means whether or not someone can get the job, get to school. And since many people in San Diego don't have access to driving cars because of affordability or other reasons, San Diego's public transit needs to be improved to serve everyone. Transit is a lifeline. I'm gonna pass it to Alex. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Ravi, and thank you, Anna, as well, for those introductions. And now we are going to get started with our student comment portion. So we have a number of students today from high school and college age from throughout the San Diego region who prepared comments today to present to the group and to our elected officials.
Just to remind you, everyone of how the procedure is going to go, we will have 2 minutes of comment for each person. I'll give you a quick direct message in Zoom just when you're at 30 seconds, just so you are aware. And we'll get started with the first students, and the first person is going to be Denise Lopez.
Oh, hi. So, hi, my name is Denise Lopez. I'm a first year student at UCSD and a City Heights resident. I've been advocating for youth opportunity passes since I was in the ninth grade. Youth opportunity passes are non-cost transit passes for youth ages 24 and under. SANDAG approved a transit pilot program for youth 18 and under in October. However, it will not benefit youth like me. And the pilot will only last 1 year. I am a college student and most students are more than 18 years. We are the ones that depend more on public transportation. Every Friday, I take the bus, then the trolley, and another bus to get home. I often see students being turned away because they don't have money for transportation. My bus pass comes from my tuition, as it's the main reason I am able to get around. I have seen community college students and youth who work worry about transportation to get to places. We need public transportation to get to our school and jobs to succeed and give back to our community. In conclusion, funding non-cost transit pass for youth 24 and under will benefit a huge community that depends on public transportation. Thanks very much.
Thank you so much. And next, we will have Natalia.
Yes. Hi, everyone. My name is Natalia Armenta, and I'm a senior in high school at High Tech High Media Arts. And I'm here again to talk about the importance and urgency of youth opportunity passes. Youth opportunity passes are essential for accessibility, equity, and moving towards a more sustainable vision of transportation. As we know, transportation accounts for the largest sector of carbon emission and further contributes to the worsening impacts of climate change, and the future of youth is at most at risk. And as we make transportation system more efficient by creating youth opportunity passes, we can influence youth not only to have more access, but influence
I think we may have lost Natalia's connection.
Sorry, did something happen?
I think so, but I think we've got you back now. So why don't you just start again, just a couple sentences back.
Sorry about the internet issues. Is this better?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, great. I can just start again. So hi, everyone. My name is Natalia Armenta. I'm a senior in high school, and I was just talking about the importance and urgency of youth opportunity passes. Youth opportunity passes are essential for accessibility, equity, and moving towards a more sustainable vision of transportation. Transportation accounts for the largest sector of carbon emission and further contributes to the worsening impacts of climate change. And obviously the future of youth is most at risk. As we make the transportation system more efficient by creating youth opportunity passes, we can influence youth not only to have more access, but influence others to use the system to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. And something significant about this too is equity and access. I live in the South Bay area in National City and very involved with extracurriculars and overall San Diego community. However, I go to school in Point Loma, so I rely heavily on having access to public transportation to be able to get to my clubs, school, community events, or just helping out with household essentials and be able to go to grocery stores or any other place, which are often not as accessible within walking distance. Along with this, it isn't always financially accessible for everyone to be taking public transportations, because at times it comes to a decision where you either have to use that money for transit or in other needs. And youth shouldn't feel limited or denied of access of public transportation because of their financial situation. And as we know, cars themselves contribute millions of tons of carbon emissions each day and contributing to poor air quality in places like Barrio Logan and National City and places where I live. And as gas prices rise and we're working to phase out the fossil fuel industry, public transportation access is going to be more in demand. And we have seen with the pilot program, the opportunity pass programs among students have demonstrated need. And I have so many friends every day who rely on public transportation to get to school or work. And by youth having access, we can encourage them to explore more opportunities such as work experience, internships, and being more involved. And it's just so significant that we invest more into youth opportunity passes to become more widespread and build a movement to support, empower youth and not feel limited, and make transportation more accessible, equitable, and overall reduce greenhouse gas emissions. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Natalia. And next to speak, we have Evelise. Evelise, go ahead.
Hi, thank you. Yeah, my name is Evelise. I'm a current senior at Otay Ranch, which is down in the South Bay at the Sweetwater District. So my story takes place during my sophomore year of high school about 2 years ago, around the time during which I was 15 years old. By this time, I had been used to riding the city bus after school every day with my group of friends, and I was used to the erratic arrivals of the bus at my station. One particular afternoon, however, I did have to attend a Saturday school, and of course my parents couldn't pick me up, so I did decide to take the bus home. I remember it was a very hot day. I was uncomfortable and tired from just a long day, and I got to the bus stop and sat down, waited for about 5 minutes. I had been all alone. Usually, as I said, I went with a group of friends that took the bus, but because it was a Saturday, I had no one with me, and so I was all by myself. Of course, as a young girl growing up so close to the border, I had heard the stories and the countless warnings about human trafficking so close to home. So I was already pretty anxious about the journey, especially since it'd been my first time taking the bus alone. I sat there, I remember, for about 5 minutes and decided to call up a friend who, of course, was busy. So they only got to speak to me for about 20 minutes. But even so, after I got off that phone, I realized that 20 minutes had already passed, which was an unusual wait time for my bus. I remember sitting there, my anxiety kept rising. I was very anxious and I ended up waiting for about 20 more minutes, which altogether came out to be 40 minutes of me waiting for this bus to come. At one point I thought maybe it was a holiday and, you know, being a young girl is a very stressful situation. Eventually, of course, the bus does show up and I got home. But my story is one that's not just exclusive to me. There are countless of people that go through this, and I'm just thankful that the wrong person didn't walk by at the wrong time. And so I'm really hoping that we can push for 10-minute intervals for the buses, because it really is, it becomes a dangerous situation when you're there for longer than warranted. And that's it. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Evans, for sharing that story. And next, we will have Gaurish.
Thank you. When I first moved to my new home and visited the closest shopping complex, I saw a bus stop nearby. It had that stereotypical black bench and metallic roof look. Yet the thing is, in my 5 years here, I've rarely seen a bus go by. But back then, I rationalized this with the fact that cars were already more prevalent in our community for transportation. But the thing is, even in more privileged communities, not everybody has that privilege to drive. My father, for the past few months, has lost his ability to drive due to his battle with cancer. He must rely on others to drive with him, which limits his ability to drive, limits his ability to commute independently. He is unable to shop for groceries or travel. And while he may regain this ability in the future, I'm forced to think about the issue at hand. Constituents who do not have 10-minute bus rides and cannot drive are unable to efficiently commute and be a part of the community. They are unable to live independently, save money, and commute to their jobs. They are essentially separated from activities, events, and the community most of us take for granted. That is why there needs to be bus service every 10 minutes, minimum. Bus service every 10 minutes would allow greater quality of life to those who do not have the means to drive. After all, what is the use of an empty bus stop? Thank you.
Thank you so much, Gaurish. And next, we will have Ravi. I'm not sure I actually see Ravi.
Ravi, it's your turn.
I saw him in the waiting room a second ago, so maybe we can go back to him.
Sorry, I think it just went away. I'm back. So one thing about public transit obviously needs to play a larger role in the way we get around. And one thing that's really important in terms of making our transit stations better is for them to have bathrooms and water fountains. Public bathrooms are one of the lifelines we are advocating for as part of a high quality public transit system. It's important that people who wait for the bus or train have access to bathrooms, and that will improve the user experience of people riding transit. At a few of the transit stations, such as the Sabre Springs Transit Station, we have huge parking garages which are underutilized, and there are no bathrooms. At some stations, such as the Sereno Valley train station, where there are bathrooms, they aren't really connected to a sanitation system, they're porta potties. So another thing, we need to have real bathrooms with connected to the sanitation system, and they need to be high quality and clean. And another thing, sometimes when we have bathrooms, they don't have soap or they aren't clean. We need to have clean public restrooms, and they're important to improve the amenities we have at transit stations and improve the user experience of people riding transit. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Robin. And next, we will have Monica.
Hi, my name is Monica Nelson, and I am a graduate student at UC San Diego. And I've been advocating for climate action since I was in high school and became concerned concerned to the point of action about the future I was facing. And as I grew older, I became increasingly aware that the severity of the climate crisis was going to be much worse for other communities beyond my own. Here in San Diego, as was mentioned in the introduction, nearly half the region's greenhouse gas emissions come from transportation. Emissions which are not only bad for the climate, but also for human health. We have, there has been a transition to using methane-powered natural gas buses in San Diego, which are better in terms of reducing particulate emissions, but they still emit CO2. And even like as a cyclist, I often find myself sitting at a stoplight behind a bus being like blasted with the hot fumes. And I can only imagine that it's not healthy as well as not being pleasant. And furthermore, the extraction of methane via thrash processes releases toxins into the environment that nearby communities are living in. But it doesn't have to be this way. The city could electrify its bus fleet. I recently learned that 17% of China's bus fleet was electric, whereas here in California, cities are like excited if we have a handful of electric buses in our city fleets. So this really showed to me that it is very feasible to have an electric city bus fleet. And I really want to call on SANDAG to pressure MTS to commit to rapidly phasing its fleet to fully electric buses, with a statewide goal of having the California electricity system being decarbonized. Electrifying our bus fleet will notably contribute to drawing down emissions, as well as reducing some of those toxic pollutants that are being put into our atmosphere through through bus emissions and fracking. So this will be an improvement for the region's communities and really improve the overall quality of life for everyone. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Monica. And next we will have Wesley.
You want me on? Okay, all right. Well, so hello everyone. My name is Wesley Cooksey, and I am a commuter student at San Diego State University. And I've been working and I've been very interested in public transit advocacy since high school in 2013. Speaking of which, in 2013, I came back to San Diego after a trip to Boston, the city where I became inspired to become a transportation planner. And one of the things that inspired me was their transit announcements, how clear they were and how helpful they were in getting me around the system and the city. So when MTS installed a new automated announcement system on our city buses the following year, I was excited and then I was disappointed. The current announcement system on our city buses is a monotone computer voice that lacks any human character, and worse, it doesn't call out every stop the bus approaches. Instead, for a large number of stops on each route, the passenger info system just scrolls the name of the stop, but no announcement plays. Then there are times when the audio system is broken and doesn't play at all, when the LED display is turned off, or the volume is too low that I can barely hear the announcements. Now, this has me worried because I think about first-time passengers trying to figure out where they are on our buses because they don't understand or don't feel inclined to listen to the announcements. This worries me because, but I'm more concerned for students and passengers overall who may be blind and unable to see stops that quietly scroll across the displays without a verbal announcement to accompany. A large proportion of disabled residents rely on public transportation and need to know that they're on the right route and when their stop is coming up. I believe our transit system should be more user-oriented, such that people can feel safe, they know where they're going, and can easily find their way around our transit system and our city. Accessible public transit is critical in San Diego because it connects people to work, education, attractive destinations, and even to friends and family. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Wesley. And next up to speak, we will have Lonnie.
Hello. I'm a student at SDSU and I live in Chula Vista.
It has become more and more prevalent that climate disruption is occurring and having impacts on communities around the globe. So climate action needs to become more and more urgent and an integral part of our daily lives, both on an individual level as a community and on larger scales. Having more access to public transportation is one of the many steps that we can take and a front where individuals in their city can work hand in hand. Unfortunately, it is not always easy and accessible to engage in this type of climate action. For me, the nearest trolley station is about 5 miles away, which is a 12-minute drive and about 28 minutes by bike. Taking public transportation is a wonderful way to reduce our personal carbon footprints. And if these resources were more readily available and accessible to more people, that is a significant amount of carbon saved from being released into the atmosphere. In our fast-paced lives, convenience is something that is greatly valued and determines a lot of our actions. It is not convenient and it doesn't really make much sense to drive my car 12 minutes to the trolley to take to school every day. So much pressure is placed on the individual to make significant lifestyle changes in our lives to help mitigate climate change and reduce our carbon footprints, which can go a long way. But when these resources that help us make these changes aren't readily available to all, it makes things difficult. Although it is important to encourage individual action, it is also important to address that we need a system that supports us. I want to help bring down my individual carbon footprint, and I want it to be easier and more inviting for everyone in San Diego to do so as well, not just for environmental reasons, but also just for the sake of a more efficient and accessible public transportation system. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And last for this section of student comments, we will have Kiala speak.
Thank you, Alex. Hi, everyone. I'm Kiala Minicho. I'm a sophomore at Canyon Crest Academy, and I am also the Youth of the Oil intern. So I work with San Diego 350, helping ensure that we can have a just transition away from fossil fuels, which is part of the reason why I believe it is so important that I'm talking to you and all the youth on this that are on this call are talking to you today, because not only does public transportation help decrease the need for fossil fuels and help mitigate and lessen the effects of our climate crisis, but it also makes it a lot easier in our everyday lives. My school, Canyon Crest Academy, is a school that's a public high school that's available to everyone in our district. That means that anyone that wants to go to this good, a really good school, can be able to access it if they apply, because it's not zoned. Essentially, this creates a big issue though, because we don't have, within our district, we do not have any bus systems, and we do not have any public transportation within the area of our school. So for example, I have friends that live in Encinitas that have to drive an hour just to get to their school. And this is a huge commute, and along with traffic, it makes the whole situation worse. We have about 8 schools, I wanna say within a 5-mile radius of our school, which means that that combined with normal everyday commuters can make what is normally a 5-minute, 2-mile drive. For me, that can take 30 minutes if I'm caught at the wrong time, which is essentially in the hours that everyone travels to school. So that means that I have to leave at a significantly earlier time than everyone else in order to just be able to get to school on time. And I know many students face similar issues, which is why I am really begging you and asking everyone on this panel to please consider routes to schools and implementing more public transportation within North County. Because while I'm privileged enough to live near a really good school, anyone that is wanting to go to a good school may not have that opportunity. And I think it's really critical that we include students in these conversations. So thank you so much. And I'll pass it back to Alex.
Thanks so much, Kiala. And we'll pause here give a chance before Supervisor Lawson Remer has to leave us today to give her a chance to respond and to answer some questions from our group here. So to moderate that, I am going to pass it right back to Kiala.
Great, awesome. Thank you so much. First of all, I just really want to uplift the incredible positivity in the chat. You all are so supportive of each other. It's amazing. And also the very thoughtful and insightful comments and points. Just heads up, we have a fellowship program in my office, so you're eligible if you're still in school. So please chase down my team if you're interested in a fellowship, because I am pretty blown away by everyone on this call. And think you guys could do hugely impactful work in trying to drive this agenda from inside the county. That all being said, I think everything people said here was very persuasive. I just want to take a minute and just kind of be real with the situation, which is, yes, I totally agree. We need buses. We need clean buses that don't spew fossil fuels out the back. We need them to come on a regular schedule, so you're not sitting there waiting for 40 minutes. Absolutely, we need ways to get to school that are fair and equitable and allow public transit. I have a 2.5-year-old. I'm already thinking about how the heck is she going to get to and from school when I'm at work, because I'm a single mom and she's going to need a bus and there's no buses. So I think all of your points are really on point. I grew up here but I also lived in New York and Washington, D.C. For nearly two decades. So I spent a lot of time without a car, getting around on, trains and subways and metros and bikes. I actually biked everywhere when I lived in New York. I got doored by a semi, so that was terrible. But but the reason I say all this is that I think everything you all say is totally right on, but we have a problem, which is all this costs a lot of money. And so if we're going to get serious about investing in these kinds of transit solutions for our future, we need to figure out how to raise the revenue. And I think it's just important to put that out there, because it's not just about having a wish list, it's about having a strategy to make that real. And I think a lot of times, you all probably hear from elected officials saying, yeah, we support that, that's great. And I'm just going to sit here and say, I support that, but we can only do it if we can figure out how to raise the revenue. So there is a opportunity this in 2022. There is a ballot measure that's going to be on the ballot that's being put together by a citizens initiative. It's a SANDAG measure that would raise sales taxes by 0.5 cent. And that would go towards a lot of these investments that we've been talking about today, in terms of safer transit, in terms of more rapid transit, in terms of buses that come more often. Also on the agenda for the SANDAG plan is a purple line, which would go from Otay to Sereno and going out basically going from through kind of all of our most dense population corridors, and as well as making the coast train much faster, and then also doing a lot of investments in smaller and more rapid buses and bike lanes. So that's all on the agenda. I'm going to pause for a second, because I saw very quickly a question that I thought seemed really interesting. Let's see. It said something about the tax. MTS is pointing out that the sales tax, which funds them, is a regressive tax, meaning that impacts people with less money. Yeah, I think that's probably true. I would agree with that. And I think, that's why I said I'm not going to sit here and tell you guys a bunch of stuff that just sounds good. We have to figure out where to find revenue. And I think that's probably the tax most likely to pass that we actually have the power to levy at a local level. You don't have a lot of local taxing powers, and that's one of the few that you have at SANDAG. So there's really not other options, to be frank. So I think the way that you deal with that regressive nature of a sales tax is that you make progressive investments with the revenue from that sales tax. In other words, you make transit passes free for young people, for people with disabilities across the board. You invest in routes that service low and moderate income communities. I think that's, you know, so we all know that the least regressive kind of taxation is a graduated income tax. And the only entity that's allowed to levy an income tax is the federal government. So we can't do that in San Diego. But if we want to tax policy, I think I'm probably out of time. So all that, I just want to tell you guys, I love everything you're doing and would love everyone's help in trying to move forward the needle on some of the pragmatic solutions, which is how do we raise the revenue to make these investments that you all are talking about today. And also if anyone wants to apply for a fellowship, I love you all. So that's all I have to say. And I have to go pick up my daughters. That's why I don't have too much longer. But I do want to open up the floor for a couple questions. So Kiala, you're a moderator, right?
Yes, I am. I have a couple questions ready for you. So if you're down for it, the first question is, what are some of the roadblocks to passing and implementing the plan?
So let me answer that clearly. There's two different things on the table, and I think they keep getting conflated. So there's the SANDAG Regional Transportation Plan that is a plan that SANDAG has to pass that basically says, like, if we theoretically had money, what we would maybe do with it. But since there's no money, it's a plan without funding, right? Then, but it's important because it's sort of like, what's our priorities as a region? Like, what do we care about? What's important? And that's going to be voted on by the SANDAG Board on the 10th of December. So I'll talk a little bit about that. The second thing is the measure, which is what I was just saying. And that has nothing to do with SANDAG. That I'm not involved with. That's a citizens initiative. A group of citizens has put that together and is bringing that on the ballot. And that has to go to the voters, because any taxes have to go to the voters due to California's propositions that require tax measures to go to the voters. So they're separate. So what are the barriers to passing on December 10th? That's just making sure we have enough votes on the board of SANDAG. So what I would suggest folks do, if you're concerned, if you want to get involved in making sure that the vote on the 10th for the SANDAG plan passes, look at the SANDAG board and send a letter to the members of the SANDAG board. I'm on it. Catherine's on it. But look on the SANDAG website, look at the board, send a letter, have folks send letters to the members of that board and have people turn out to testify on the 10th with the kind of testimony you all shared today, I think is really powerful. So that's sort of a half of it. The other half is, how do we pass this measure? That's where the rubber hits the road, and that's where the work gets hard, because there are a lot of people who don't want to pass this measure because they don't want to pay more taxes. And those people are your parents. So you all have some work to do. And those people are your parents, they're your grandparents, they're your teachers, they're your neighbors. So this is, in a way, like, really up to you to do the work, to get educated about the measure and have a sit down. So have a sit down with your parents, have a sit down with your neighbors, have a sit down with your teachers and say, this is important to my future. This is the future I want. And mom, dad, I understand that you all are not going to be taking the bus. I understand that you all might not take the train. You all might not bike, but I will. And I want to grow up in a San Diego, and I want to raise my family in a San Diego that, like, leans in to alternatives, because it leans into climate solutions. It leans into a clean energy future. It leans into the kind of equity that transit brings, that provides accessibility to all members of our community, regardless of disabilities or economic status. And that, to be honest, is not an area that elected officials can lead. So people should not be looking to elected officials to lead on that. That's look to yourself, because this is up to the voters. And you all each know, you know, honestly, at least 10 voters, at least 15 voters that you could go sit down with and tell them why it's important to you and to your future to pass this measure. And I think that's where you all could make a huge difference to the future of San Diego. If you start getting organized with talking points, start talking to everyone you know, get on, and you know, it's not just like a social media post. It's like, have a real conversation.
Yes, Most definitely. And I think you probably only have about 2 minutes left, so and you need to get going. So probably only one more question. What are, I guess everyone wanted to know, kind of just speaking from your perspective, what are your priorities in terms of transportation in the San Diego region? What do you think is most important and critical?
God, what do I think is most, well, I'll begin with bike routes because I'm a big biker. And I think, you know, it does a lot of things. Biking does a lot of things. It connects sort of the fabric of our community. People are more likely to stop at a store if they're biking past instead of driving. And it gets people, you know, biking is automatically clean and climate friendly, plus it's healthy. So, you know, maybe we would have less medical expenses if people were biking around. So I think there's just tons of advantages to that. And as you know, as more folks get comfortable with like electric bikes, for example, people's like willingness to sort of do first and last mile on a bike or bike to and commute to work. So I think protected and connected, plus it's warm out all the time. So we should have protected and connected bike lanes in San Diego County. It's crazy. This place that's just so beautiful. You can't bike safely. I do it, but I am aware that it feels dodgy like at best. So I think that's a huge priority for me. Second is I would just say safety in general, sort of transportation safety across the board. So we do have, and safety and facilities. So we do have facilities, but like some folks said on this call, we'll have like a porta potty and not a real bathroom, or, you know, you won't have lights at a station. So there's places where we already kind of have the beginnings of infrastructure, but we haven't put the resources in to make it safe for and like accessible for folks. So I think that's a second big priority is the safety infrastructure, and that includes bathrooms, lights, making sure that we have enough people on the transit systems that people feel safe and they can be safe, and really making our existing transit system usable and functional. Because right now it's way, way hitting below capacity and possibility. So I think kind of improving our existing transit system to make it work. And then I think the third thing for me is the train, the coast train, because it's already there, the tracks are already there, but it's incredibly slow. You know, it's like an hour to get from Encinitas downtown. And if we do go forward with these investments, it would be 17 minutes, which would be huge and would unclog the whole five, because right now the five is so crowded, and it would also really increase interconnectedness in our communities so that our entire coast is more integrated and more people have beach access and more people have downtown access, which I think both are very important. And then I think the last would be this purple line, which I think is really exciting because it would wind through a lot of the kind of core, more populated parts of our city and connect with jobs in Sereno Valley. So those are four. And I know you said one, but I have too many. And then the fifth one is school, figuring out how we could have bring back some kind of transit system or buses for people to get to school. And we probably can't do everything, not at once, but at least we could tackle maybe like our magnet schools.
Yes, well, I completely agree with you. As someone who bikes to school every day, biking is super important. Getting transportation to schools, very, very important. And I'm so glad to have you be able to comment on this. And it's just such like so many good things to hear that elected officials care about what we're saying and that they're actively interested in having to hear about our input, because we're going to be the generation that is going to be using a lot of public transportation. So with that, I just want to give a big virtual round of applause to Supervisor Lawson Remer, and have an amazing rest of your day. And with that, I will pass it to Alex.
Thank you all, and thank you for all your work.
Right, great. Thank you. Thank you, Supervisor, and thank you, Kiala, for moderating the questions and the discussion. And we will now continue on with our next set of student speakers to the panel. We will start with Amanda.
All right, thank you, Alex. My name is Amanda. I live in Oceanside and I'm a fourth year student at UCSD. I commute to campus multiple times a week. And while I prefer to use public transit as much as possible, our public transit system here in San Diego County can be so inconvenient that I'm often forced to take a car if I have access to one and end up spending more than I can even afford as a student on gas and parking. One day last month, for example, I left campus around 7 p.m. After an undergrad club meeting, and I was shocked to find that actually the last bus connecting to the nearest coaster station, which is a really popular route for commuting students and staff, had already left half an hour earlier, and it wasn't even dark yet at that point. And that's also an MTS bus that only leaves once per hour after 3:30 p.m. anyways, and doesn't even run most of the day at all. So I had to wait for a different bus, which itself stops running at only 10 p.m., to take me a longer route up to Oceanside. And by the time I got there, the last Sprinter commuter train had already left as well. So I had to wait again in the dark this time for someone to come pick me up driving anyway, which sort of defeated my whole goal of using public transit to get to school. So it's at the point where if I don't have access to a car, don't want to drive a car, can't afford gas right now, my educational, social, and career opportunities are automatically limited by the inconvenience of our transit system. So if we want to increase ridership, we need to make public transit in San Diego a viable option to replace cars for commuters, and that will require more frequent and reliable bus and train service, with 24-hour-a-day transit options on popular routes, especially in communities where access to cars is reduced. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Amanda. And next up to speak, we will have Wesley.
Hello again. And let's see, so as a commuter student at SDSU, I have lived in the Rolando neighborhood for about 20 years. That's about a mile or so to the southeast of the campus. And I've come to enjoy using our transit system as my means of commuting because I feel more comfortable when I'm with other people instead of alone in my car. Whenever I'm driving, by contrast, I often feel nervous because I'm worried about making a fatal mistake behind the wheel, or getting into conflict with a more aggressive driver. We have very aggressive drivers in the college area. I understand, however, and Sierra pointed this out, that many young people, especially friends of mine at State, don't feel comfortable riding public transit in San Diego, but a large part of that is due to the gap in frequencies among multiple other variables. At night especially, I have had to wait in a dark bus shelter at College Avenue and El Cajon Boulevard for my Route 1 connection with nobody around me, despite the flow of cars in front. And I've had many moments where I've missed my connection with the Route 1 bus and have had to walk home because the next bus is 30 minutes away. It's just luck that I live within a far walking distance of that stop, and my neighborhood isn't especially dangerous at night because, as we've heard, there are many like me who do not have those advantages. I want my classmates from State and youth in San Diego overall to not only feel comfortable riding the bus and the trolley, but to have a fun and relaxing time on transit like I do on the majority of my commutes. To do that, we need more frequent service and bus stops that are all sheltered and properly lit at night. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Wesley. And next up, we will have Monica.
Hi, thanks all. Sorry, let me just get this up. Okay, so I spoke to you earlier. You know who I am. I'm Monica Nelson, a grad student at UC San Diego. And I do not own a car, so I rely on public transit and more heavily my bike to get around. And I just want to really emphasize that my bike is my lifeline to transportation and to getting around. It's not just a means of recreation. Here in San Diego, I do notice that most of the best bike infrastructure is out in the suburbs, and yet the cycling infrastructure that I rely on to get to school and to get groceries is seriously lacking. I live in the UTC area near UCSD, where most of the roads are 4 to 6 lanes wide, and bike lanes are an on-again, off-again phenomenon. So each trip to get to school or to get groceries or to socialize is a fearsome challenge, as Supervisor Lawson Remer said. To get to school, I have to navigate La Jolla Shores Drive, which has no bike lanes, is lined with parked cars, is a moonscape of potholes ready to throw you off your bike, and has cars that are ready to straddle the center line or even pass you on the left to overtake you on blind corners. And it's quite frankly terrifying. Another essential trip I have to make by bike is getting groceries. And despite the fact that I live within a mile as the crow flies of 4 different grocery stores, I can't get to a single one on a continuous bike lane. And that's despite living in graduate housing, which is a concentrated known area of housing and of people that will need to eat. When I want to go further afield or to socialize off campus and go to off campus events, I need to combine biking with public transit. And yet the bike infrastructure is not well integrated into the city public transit system. One example of this is the new Gilman Transit Center that's on the UCSD campus, which has no dedicated bike through corridor. So you have buses pulling in and out of the same lane that has cars in it and bikes in it, and it's just a pretty chaotic mess. So I'm really feeling that the city needs to improve cycling infrastructure to make it safe and enjoyable for people to cycle commute in San Diego. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Monica. Next up, we will have Ravi.
Hi, I'd like to speak about housing near public transit. Another thing that's important when we're talking about improving public transit is that we need to be building more housing near transit lines, jobs, restaurants, retail, and grocery stores, so that we are building areas better for walking and to enable more people to take the public transit that we build. Overall, we need more housing in our region and our state, as we have a huge imbalance between the jobs our economy is producing and our housing stock at all income levels, but particularly at lower income levels. We have to be building more affordable housing in addition to permanent supportive housing and move towards providing everyone with a right to a low-cost home. To do this, we also need to end exclusionary zoning, which limits the supply of housing, making it less affordable. At the same time, another thing to keep in mind is that when we build high quality public transit, particularly trains or trolley stations, we need to ensure that this doesn't result in gentrification. So it doesn't enable local landlords to raise rents because of increasing demand for people to live near transit stops. Housing and land use are very connected with public transit. And in order to enable people to use transit, we need to build more housing and affordable housing along transit lines.
Thank you so much, Ravi. And next up to speak, we will have Kat.
Hi, everyone. My name's Kat Eamon. I'm a student at San Diego City College. I'm also an AFT intern, and I live in the neighborhood of Birdland.
I just wanted to share that next semester I'll be returning to San Diego City College in person, and I'd love to take public transportation as well as my two kids who are attending a middle school nearby. When I checked the trip details on the Pronto app, I found that it would take my kids an hour and 11 minutes to go a distance of 3 miles. 31 minutes of that would be spent walking, and their first bus would only run every 30 minutes. I found that my trip to City College would be similar. So I would just love to see a more efficient system with more options and less time in between services. My kids are extremely frightened about climate change and desperately want to cut down our families' carbon emissions, as do I. Over the next 15 years or so, my kids are going to be attending academic institutions here in San Diego County. It would be wonderful if the county could provide them with better support via the transit system, especially if the cost of their fares could be eliminated. I think that would be a huge incentive for them to take public transit and would certainly alleviate the burden, not only monetarily, but time-wise for our family, as well as give us a significant opportunity to do our part in the fight against climate change. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Kat. And finally, we will have Anna Isabel.
Thank you, Alex. Like Kat, I'm a full-time student at San Diego City, and I'm also an AFT intern at the local 1931. My name is Ana Isabel Serrano, and before the Blue Line extension opened just 2 weeks ago, it would take me an hour to get to my school. Now it'll take me 40 minutes. For reference, this is merely a 5-minute drive. Before, I lived in Chula Vista, and it would take me about 2 hours and 3 buses to get to school. With a car, it would have only been 20 minutes. It currently takes me 1 hour to get to work, an hour and a half if I choose the route I feel safest in. This is only a 12-minute drive. On the days I leave at night, I'm forced to order a $15 Uber or Lyft or ask a coworker for a ride because the bus route I take is no longer available after 5:30. If I'd still live in my past neighborhood, I simply couldn't have agreed to do this internship at all. It's not only the fact that it takes a ridiculous amount of time to get places, it's also a matter of safety. As a young woman taking the Green Line trolley and several MTS bus routes throughout the week, I do not feel safe. I'm constantly insulted and harassed. I've been yelled at, followed, and once even physically assaulted. The stations I frequent are also situated between freeway entrances and exits that make it dangerous for pedestrians to cross the street. I know I've almost been hit by a car several times, and no, it wasn't because I was looking at my phone. Needless to say, I try to avoid using public transportation when it's dark, which means that ever since the time change last month, I need to get home by 4:30. There's a variety of reasons people don't drive, psychological, physical, ethical, or financial, amongst many others. Whichever the reason, one should not be made to feel punished or impaired or any less capable because of choosing to take public transportation. As things are, I'm not incentivized in the least to continue using public transportation. This city was built for driving. It should be the other way around. People should want to take public transportation. It should be the easier, faster, safer, and greener alternative, as it already is in many parts of the world. A great place to start is by the expansion of the routes and hours of service available in order to help connect the communities of San Diego and support all of us who depend on transit for our daily lives, especially high school and college students. I'm personally excited to see all of us be a part of this shift and hopeful it will happen soon. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Anne. That was great. And next we are going to, I'm going to check actually quickly with, Katie, would we like to do the word cloud now?
So we actually skimmed over this, earlier. So Monica, if you wouldn't mind sharing, this screen again, So we really, because we have a lot of people in the audience, we want to hear what transportation justice means to you. So we're gonna do a really quick exercise with a word cloud. So I want to encourage everyone to take a quick second and answer this question by either scanning the QR code or going to the link in the chat and filling out that form and just what is transportation justice? Why does the transportation justice matter to you? And then we are gonna be able to see that in the form of a word cloud. So please take a couple minutes. Fill out the link. All right, I think I'll wait like another minute for more people to add their responses. Thank you all. Lots of good responses. All right, Monica, if you want to exit out of that slide and then go to the next one. All right, so this is what we found, that transportation justice matters to a lot of you. So I see a lot of you talking about justice, about climate, about access, opportunity, accessibility, safety, and we will have the final word cloud available after this to be able to share as well. So thank you all, and I think it's really important to hear from everyone's perspectives. So now I'm gonna pass it back over to Kiala.
Thank you so much, Katie. And those words, that word cloud is really interesting to see, and I had a lot of those similar thoughts. So now that we've heard all of our student comments, I want to open it up to the rest of the elected officials. We have a couple of questions, and just a reminder to please put your questions in the chat. The faster you put your question in, the faster it will most likely get answered. So I guess we can get started. So for all of our elected officials, you can choose which one you want to answer. So just speak if you want to talk about this.
I was gonna say I can jump in and answer some questions, and then I also have to get going and pick up my kids. So I wanted to make sure that I had a chance to respond.
Okay, yes, of course. Then maybe you can take this first question from Sierra. As we expand the MTS routes and empower students to use the systems, how are we raising awareness of commercial sexual exploitation against youth on public transportation? Unfortunately, there are trolley stops that have been flagged as hotspots as a recruitment for child exploitation. Are there training for MTS to identify child trafficking
And prevention really matters in creating safe transportation. And it's super important. And she says, thank you for the space. So I imagine that's a very lengthy question, but maybe tackle.
That's an important question. So let me just say a couple things, sort of bigger picture. So I want to echo what the supervisor said before she left about the amazing positivity in the comments. I don't know if this is a generational thing or what, but you don't really see that kind of like ongoing praising of what people are saying. And also sometimes it can be scary to speak publicly. And so you're, you know, reaffirming that people are doing something good with what their words are. And it's great. And also shows active listening. So I just want to really recognize that this chat is amazing. So there's been a lot of great feedback. Some of it is very specific to, like, I would say that actual transit operators, and there aren't people who are in elected office or who are the staff members of like MTS or NCTD on this call that I'm aware of. I mean, maybe they are, but I'm not aware of them. So some of the very specific feedback about lighting, or if you can hear the audio, or, you know, even like how the training of MTS staff members happens when they're on related to trafficking, you know, the truth is I'm just not at that level where I'm able to offer a feedback on that or be engaged in that. I'm not on those transit boards. But I do think, of course, trafficking is horrible and a problem, and we need to do everything we can to stop it in every public space. So just across the board, you know, condemnation of everyone involved in that industry and the importance of recognizing stopping it. You know, the reality of a lot of these very aspirational statements is that we need to have climate champions like Councilmember Jack Shu, who is on this Zoom. He's probably going to answer questions after me. You know, he was an advocate who would speak at the SANDAG board meeting after meeting after meeting until he raised his hand and said, I want to be in the arena too, and I want to make decisions, and I want to sit on that board. And so, you know, we need all of your voices to be on the outside offering comments. And then we also need you to step up and say, I want to participate and make hard choices. And what you see, I mean, a lot of the comments, I think we all of us on this call agree with them, but they are very aspirational. And the reality of where you're spending money, especially when transit just as an entire category has structural deficits. So it never breaks even when it comes to just fare box recovery. So you're always having to advocate for money and have priorities focus on, we want to provide better transit and we want to improve our road network, like for biking and walking. And we want there to be equity and we want there to be climate resilience and we want to serve more communities. You know, so we have these like bigger goals. And then the real like rubber meets the road is, where are we finding the money? Where are we allocating the money? And are we saying yes or no to things? So in my experience in local government, I'll just give a quick example of when I was first elected, we had a really controversial SANDAG project around a rail trail. And it was one of these things where I had always thought, why can't I go in the rail corridor? Why won't they put a little trail in there near my house to get to downtown Encinitas from downtown Cardiff? There's plenty of space. And then I happened to be on the city council elected 5 months when SANDAG came forward and said, hey, we want to put a rail trail there. And I was like, oh my gosh, this is an amazing gift. It's just been delivered to me. And what I realized then was that the reason we didn't have that was this swelling of community opposition to it, where it, in the end, they didn't want the fence that stopped them from crossing the railroad tracks illegally. They didn't want their historic unpermitted use of that space for their own dog park or whatever all the reasons were. They didn't want parking disrupted. They didn't want to bring foreigners in or people from out of town or whatever all the fears were and opposition to change. And local government officials are always representing communities. So the voices that come forward to say, we want this and say yes, that is the critical part. Because what I feel like is there are always voices to say no, always. And they are very loud and they are very threatened. They feel like you are taking something from them. So when all the things that you're asking for in aggregate, there are changes that are changing the way we use public space. And all of that is contested and it will always be. And so, you know, the kind of hand-to-hand combat of it, of not only speaking to the like-minded, but getting into the forums where people don't agree with you, and say and encouraging the professional staff and the electeds who are doing the things you want, and not cutting them off at the knees, but saying like, yes, do more of this. We want to support this. How can we help do that? You know, those are the ways that we are actually able to move the needle. And I'll also just say, I mean, I just have to say it. It's political. So who you elect to sit on these seats matters. And if you elect people who don't see, have these same values as you, because on some other subject they agree with you or whatever, you're not going to see these transportation improvements. So, you know, we have a highly political board right now at SANDAG, which is unfortunate. It hasn't always been that way, but it is like pitched right now. And it's difficult because we're always trying to work across the aisle. But in the end, we're trying to make progress. We're trying to have a regional plan that's different than the previous regional plan. We're trying to invest more in transit and in biking and walking. And those are not easy decisions. So sometimes it can seem like this is so obvious. Like, why is it not happening? But the reality is there are these undercurrents of status quo and opposition for a different vision that says most people drive. We should invest in the road network to allow most people to continue driving. Like, and that is just a totally different worldview. And it is held by many, many people. So, and Tara talked extensively about the regional plan and the votes around that and that. So I won't go into that. But I just wanted to say all those comments and to really thank everybody for their participation and involvement in this. It does really matter.
Yes, most definitely. Very much echoing all the points that council, mayor, and Chair Blakespear has said. Our next question from Sheila is, green infrastructure must acknowledge arrested mobility, i.e. biking, walking as Black. I don't know if that's more of a question or a statement, but would anyone want to comment on that?
It's a question in the sense that when we need to talk about arrested mobility, about Black and brown travelers, and I may have missed it, but I didn't hear that. That needs to be front and center when we talk about climate justice, because that's racial justice that needs to go hand in hand. Thanks.
Okay, would anyone want to talk about how we can address this issue or comment on this?
I mean, I'd like to let Councilmember Shu answer because he is very articulate on subjects and he's been patiently waiting.
Okay, Councilmember Shu.
Thank you. And thank you, Catherine, because, you know, your leadership on the SANDAG board is quite remarkable, and it's not an easy job. We have a very difficult 19-member board. When we deal with transportation justice and equity issues, I like to think we can take a few steps back and start redefining and relooking at the whole problem, the inequities, the systems inequities that have in place. We have this notion that driving should be free. People complain about the transit passes and letting people ride transit for free when we have been giving free parking for drivers everywhere, and people expect it. And yet someone's paying for that parking space. Either the store is paying for it, Costco is paying for it, or the city is paying for it. Yet drivers expect it. And when you don't give it to them, they complain. The same is happening with a number of other factors. But if we can rethink transit and systems, and particularly for advocates, you have a great list, the 10 list, but I would say take a step back and use your voice to define who you're talking about, who the services you want, and define the level of service you want, that you want safe, affordable, effective transportation that's competitive with driving. That's the bottom line. It's not a project, it's not a program, it is a condition, and that should be measured. And I can tell you right now, hardly anyone is measuring that. We have data on asthma, on emergency cases of asthma in the hospitals, and we know that incidence is much higher in certain communities. We have data on who gets hit by cars And that someone in certain parts of this region, their chances of getting hit by a car is many times higher than other parts of the region. That's not used though in transportation planning in terms of where we want to fix transportation issues. So even the data we do have is not being defined or used. And I'm sorry to say that collectively, we failed, that our elected officials, including myself, do a very poor job conveying these issues and trying to solve them. But we're trying to do our best and using the systems we have. So I have some other quick issues. In terms of transportation justice, define what you want. Having a bus come every 10 minutes in a particular route may not be the most effective way and cost-effective way to move people, particularly in the middle of the night. Who wants to wait at a bus stop even for 5 minutes? Why can't we provide door-to-door service? You know, if someone is drunk at 2 o'clock in the morning in a bar, we have systems in which someone will pick them up and take them home. If we could do that for someone who's drunk, we better be able to do it for a student. We better do it for a person who's working at night. And we have the funding and ability to do it. And that's the level of service we should demand. That's what we should be talking about. I hate for us to be trapped into a current system of transportation systems, which is already inadequate. That's not should be our bar. We don't want to just stick with our current system. We have communities throughout the world in which there are systems available for on-demand service. That means we pick you up 1 o'clock at night, you get off work, we pick you up and we take you back to your home. You pay a little bit, your employer should pay a little bit, and the transit system can pay a little bit, and it's affordable. We should stop talking about bus stops. There are concepts in which we have virtual bus stops. Anywhere that's safe to pick up somebody or drop off somebody can be a bus stop. Why are we stuck with this conventional system in which buses can only stop in a particular place? Why can't they go around someplace to pick up someone else? We have these beautiful systems now to map and let a bus driver know exactly where to go for these virtual bus stops, as long as it's a safe place to pick up somebody and drop off somebody. This is how we should rethink transit and use these ideas for transportation justice and just demand a certain level of service. Let the experts on transportation figure it out. MTS, redo your culture for service, not about just your dollar, bottom line. They care more about fare recovery than what we just talked about, human trafficking. Monica Montgomery is the person to go talk to. She's on the MTS board, who is relooking security issues. Nathan Fletcher is the chair. Put these things on their agenda. So let me stop there because I can go on for quite a bit longer. And I bet Teddy has a few things to say as well. Thank you.
Yes, thank you, Member Counts. Thank you so much. We really appreciate it. And the next question we have in the chat is in regards to charging for road usage. Teddy, would you want to share more about that? Are you familiar on that topic of the SANDAG plan to charge for road usage?
This is the Vehicle Miles Traveled initiative. And yeah, I'm pretty familiar with it because when I was in the state assembly in the state Senate, this was floated by a couple states who came to talk to us. How do we incentivize less vehicle travel without relying on fossil fuels? And there's a friction there with people giving data up to where they're going. So there's this immediate fear, kind of like what Mayor Blakespear was talking about. These folks who are kind of against things no matter what. And when I first heard of this idea, and this is probably 2015, 2014. So it's been an idea that has floated around different states and has proven to be effective as a pilot. But I think, most of the time folks don't like sharing their data. It's a bit of an interesting paradox of how do you get the data to understand where people are traveling and give that data up freely. Charging for road use is, it makes sense in a conceptual, kind of idea of how do you incentivize folks who are, I worked for a member in the Central Valley where most of the people were very poor and they had to travel tens of hundreds of miles to get to work or to get groceries simply because it was such a desolate, isolated area. And so just because they have to travel super far, like I'm lucky enough to live in an urban core where I can walk to a store, and so for me to not have to pay for this issue of vehicle miles traveled, it does end up being regressive, like what came up before of a tax on the initiative. And so it's complicated. And I do think that there is a better way to do a tax and to generate revenue based on how you move around. But I do think that sometimes there's a privilege in not having to use your car, not having to most people don't have a car. And so they're forced into biking or into trolley systems to do that. And so I think vehicle miles traveled is a very interesting concept, but it's tricky to do and implement just because you have to literally put in what's called a dongle into your car system so that the government can see how far you drive. And then for folks who have to drive, like many of you who have been saying, I have no option. Now you're going to be taxed more for your having no option, where people who live in places where they can walk to work or walk to a grocery store don't pay that. And so who does it punish, right? And so I think when we talk about taxation, it's complex. And while it might make sense conceptually, when put into practice, the folks who are forced onto the road for a car without necessarily wanting to be, especially people in more rural areas who already have it pretty tough. They have no access to water, no access to healthcare systems, no access to groceries. They're literally in food deserts. You end up punishing them. And so statewide, the approach was difficult and it didn't sail through the state. Doing that at a regional level could work, but I think it's very complicated. And so, I think that the look at that very critically is worth the discussion. It's a really heavy dialogue when you talk about how and why people move around via cars versus bikes and transit. So that's all I'll say. I do want to echo some points that Councilmember Shu made, which is how do we transport people that are living in different areas without punishing them? And how do we lower emissions at the same time? How do we demand certain things like safety so that folks don't have to experience hardship while they're trying to get to work, to get to school, to and from? And so I think that, a lot of the members on this panel brought up a lot of good questions. How can we all get involved? This Zoom call right now shows how this can be done, having a constructive dialogue and then targeting these things in the 18 incorporated cities throughout this county to effectuate that advocacy. And I think you all are doing an amazing job. And I think it is about the political concept of how do you get these communities who are entrenched into don't come here, or, there's so many issues politically that are embedded in this conversation. And I think polite advocacy and telling these stories that we've heard from all of these students about what they experience is what people remember. Data points are percentages. As a staffer, I get thrown numbers all day long, and they're important and they help us measure what the issue is. But when people tell stories, that's what sticks. And in a lot of these communities where people don't hear these stories because they have the luxury of not having to deal with it, hear these stories, it humanizes the problem and it allows people to really understand what people are dealing with. And I think stories go a lot further with the elected officials, but it's also on this group to then share with that, share that information with your neighbors, share that information with your parents, share that information with people that don't have to necessarily deal with it. And a story goes a long way. And so I think there's a lot of work that can be done. The council president has been making strides to make that happen through the Morena corridor, to make sure that people have access to school, especially the new trolley line. And she's going to be committed to doing that. And so I just want to, again, just say thank you to all of you who are sharing your stories. It's tough to do. This is not easy work and it doesn't happen overnight. but really it's about letting folks engage in a dialogue so they can understand why this is important. So I just want to end with that and say thank you to all the people who've shared their stories, because that's at the end of the day. I see numbers all day, but to hear the stories, those are things that stick. So thank you all for having the courage to share that with us. And let's do this work in stride.
So Kira, I think, are you past time or do you have more time?
I think we have time for one or two more questions. I think it's really critical that we address talking a little bit more about racial equity and how we are going to implement that within things like the regional transportation plan. And, you know, obviously that is a big component along with environmental justice that is going to really help make sure that what we're designing is the best solution for everyone and specifically frontline communities and people of color. So would you like to comment on that? And then also if you see a question in the chat that you'd like to answer, I can also feed you questions as well.
Let me say a few things. Maybe we could feed Teddy and I a few other questions if we have the time. There's something happening right now on the regional transportation plan, and it has to do with this vehicle miles traveled fee. First, I think we need to deal with some myths. The myth is drivers are not paying their own way. They are the ones on welfare. They get public assistance in the form of all kinds of hidden fees. They're the ones that get more public money. But however, most drivers think we're paying our own way when we pay a little bit with our gas, our other road use fee. Our current road use fee is the gas tax, and it has not worked well for a long time. It is not equitable either. It's a regressive tax because poor people have cars that don't get as much better gas mileage. Electric car drivers, if we can pick on Tesla, they get a rebate when they buy the car and they don't have to pay that gas tax. The current system is not equitable. We need to change it. The sooner we change it, the better. The sooner people who pollute pay for their pollution, the better. That's how you stop pollution. And right now, polluters get away with it. Vehicle tax would try to deal with that and put the cost of building roads and maintaining roads more on the people who actually use them. As far as where we're going with this RTP, that's coming to a head. The 19 board members of SANDAG in the last few days have received over close to probably 1,800, probably approaching 2,000 emails of people commenting negatively, mostly on the RTP. This was done politically. It was a political move to put pressure on SANDAG board members. That's what you're fighting against. Tomorrow morning at the SANDAG board meeting, we're going to be addressing that to some degree because of a false information comment system. It was not a real survey. Funneling comments at the 19 board members. And I'm hoping that our politicians, our elected officials on the SANDAG board, for the most part, will be wise enough. However, indicators are that many of them may collapse. They may weaken our movement towards having a road use fee, which is more better for poor people. They have twisted and misinformed much of the public. When we deal with security issues, for example, as Teddy mentioned, we're already tracked as to where we go. Google knows where I am all the time. It gives me a report every month. You know, if I want to use my phone effectively, Google is going to take that information. My insurance company knows my odometer reading for my car. I have to report it. We already have that. Private companies already have that information, and hopefully they use it in a manner that's not going to reveal our privacy too much. So to have that monitoring in our vehicle or some other system that we come up with is not going to be a real threat to our security. This is a false image that the public has been given, and we need to refute that. No, drivers are not paying their own way right now. We need to have them pay more. I can guarantee you, if drivers paid the real cost of driving and parking, there will be a lot fewer drivers, and vehicle miles will drop dramatically. Pollution will be much better. That's our best solution to climate change. Let the polluters who pollute pay the real cost of their pollution and not the hidden cost. I think that's how we can address that. And if we just deal with that one issue and get that information out to the community, that'll help us a lot. We're really fighting huge entities, political entities, as both Tara Lawson Remer and Catherine Blakespear just mentioned. The politics of this is really crazy. It's going to be very hard. It's not a party issue. In fact, for that matter, much of the time, when I do my advocacy work, I'm trying to fight Democrats, not Republicans. And some of them are called some of the most environmental Democrats we have. So we have a real issue in terms of really calling out all of us to do the right thing. And the bottom line is, and I've said this many times, no matter what the fuel is, the energy source is, no matter who is driving, to drag 3,000 pounds, 4,000 pounds around, if you want to get from one place to another, is a terrible system. And unfortunately, that's the infrastructure we currently have. We have to convert that. So if you start out that way and just tell people, why don't we come up with a better system from getting one place to another? Stop dragging that 3,000 pounds around. Because by dragging that 3,000 pounds around, we are using the most expensive way of traveling for government and the private individual, and the most dangerous way of traveling. Per mile travel, rail travel is 17 times safer than car travel. Any parent that cares about their children would say, get out of that car because it's too dangerous. Anyway, so I speak in that fashion or these points quite often. I hope you continue with these forums, these townhouses. There's a lot more to cover and a lot of, very complex systems we need to fix. This RTP, by the way, has to be passed on the 10th. If we do not pass it on the 10th, literally billions of federal and state monies will not come to San Diego. We endanger that. If we alter it in any way, any substance way, the environmental impact statement or report have to be redone. It would delay the RTP another 6 months or more and also endanger any money coming in. So to think that we can stop this RTP from being ratified on the 10th would be essentially economic suicide for San Diego.
Well, thank you so much, Councilmember Shu, for your opinions on that. And it's, again, I just wanted to thank all of our panelists and the electeds who have been on this call and are willing to hear our voices and really work with you who, you know, as I already said, as many have echoed, are going to be using these systems and making sure that everyone's input is heard. So again, I just want to give everyone a big round of applause to all of our panelists today. Thank you so much for spending so much time over this really critical issue. And now I'm going to pass it to Amanda to wrap it up and discuss some actions that we can all take based off of these conversations.
Sure, thanks, Kiala. If someone could share the screen. Oh, perfect. All right. So if today's forum has inspired you in any way, we highly encourage you to take further action. This is crucially important, so please don't leave the meeting yet. Listen up. We've laid out several action items here that you can get started on as soon as possible. Firstly, we encourage you to make your voice heard at the SANDAG board meeting on Zoom, December 10th at 8:30 a.m. Links will be put in the chat for how to sign up, and also a toolkit for how to spread the word and get others involved. That board meeting will be going over the regional plan and the final environmental impact report. Secondly, we encourage you to send an e-comment and email your SANDAG board member before that meeting, December 10th. Further links will be put in the chat for a toolkit and information on how to reach the board members that were not here tonight. We also encourage you to join SD350's transportation team. You can fill out a volunteer form on their website, and a link for that will also be put in the chat. Additionally, we encourage you to support youth opportunity passes, and you can pledge your support at this link here to encourage that. And then lastly, join your student environmental group or eco club. And if you don't have one, start one. If you go to UCSD, you can contact Monica, who spoke here tonight. And if you go to SDSU, you can go ahead and contact Wesley, who also made comments tonight. So thank you again, everyone, for joining us tonight. We really appreciate all of your comments. Thank you again to our elected officials for being here and participating. We massively appreciate you. And also thank you to those who put together this town hall and helped moderate. And with that, we'd like to end our youth transportation town hall. Thank you.